Okay, so this was an illustration of the algorithm where the transition probability was symmetric. So remember, Qij was equal to Qji, and therefore in the acceptance probability, they canceled out. But I can be more creative to design my Markov chain that will explore the space. And in this case, I would like to exploit the following idea. In the context of the estimation of this model, the gradient of the likelihood function provides me with a nascent direction that is pointing towards values of beta, which has a higher likelihood. This is actually what is exploited in optimization algorithms in order to solve the maximum likelihood estimation problem. So my idea here would be to exploit the gradient in the following way. Instead of performing a purely random walk around beta I, I would like to first move along the direction of the gradient in order to obtain a beta which hopefully will have a higher likelihood associated with it. I call it beta j. I said hopefully because this will depend on the value of alpha. So we know that if alpha is small, indeed the Taylor's theorem will tell us that indeed the value of the likelihood at beta j will be higher than the one at beta I. But if alpha is too long, it may not happen. So the idea here in the context of Metropolis-Hastings algorithm is to bias the search towards higher value of the likelihood. And again, I have the flexibility to do it because the only thing I have assumed in the description of the algorithm is that I have a Markov chain with a transition probability Q. So what I will have to do to apply this idea is to calculate the transition probability Q and plug it into the algorithm. So this is an illustrative representation of the idea. So I'm starting from the current state beta j. I move deterministically along the gradient by a step alpha, and I obtain the point that I call beta g. And then I apply the random walk exactly as we did before. So I generate randomly a vector xi I, and I move along it with a step lambda to obtain beta j, the next state. Here, the only random element is xi I. So therefore, basically the transition probability from I to j will be the same as before. It will depend on the distribution of xi r. So that's what I've written here. So the probability, well, in this case, it's a continuous space, so it's not the probability, it's the PDF. Let's talk about probability in a general way. The probability to move from state I to state j is simply defined as the PDF evaluated at xi r. But it's not true for the reverse probability. So remember, we started from beta I, we moved to beta g, and then we moved to beta j. And now, assuming that I am at beta j, what is the probability that my Markov process sends me back to beta I? So this is what I need to calculate, qji, the probability that I go back to the original state. So let's use the same picture. So I started from beta I, I went to beta g, and then to beta j. Now let's assume that I am at beta j, and let's apply the process again to see how can I go back to beta I. Well, the first thing is deterministic. I calculate the gradient, and I move along the gradient with a step alpha. So this is the point that is generated deterministically. This is beta j plus alpha times the gradient calculated at beta j. So it means that in order to go back to beta I need my random walk to generate this vector here, up to lambda. So basically the probability that I go to beta I is the probability that my random walk generates a vector that is linking this point, beta j plus alpha times the gradient, and this point, beta I, if I make a step of length lambda along it. So let's write the equation of this. So beta I is obtained by starting from this point, which is this one, and moving with a step lambda along the generated xi. The xi is generated from the random walk. And the probability to do that is given by the PDF of xi j. And if you derive xi j from this equation, well, you obtain this. So this is the formula for the backward probability. And as you can see, this is definitely different from the forward probability. So this is the Python code. The main difference is that now we have to calculate the gradient. So we have here access to the gradient. We calculate a step along the gradient. Again, we calculate the log of the posterior. And then I apply the algorithm in exactly the same way. But now I just have to take into account that the Qij and Qji are different. So this is the random walk. I move along the random walk direction from beta grad, right? I calculate the likelihood and its gradient at the new point. I calculate the gradient step for the new point. I will need it to calculate the backward probability. And I calculate the log of the posterior for the new point. The forward probability Qij is simply given by the normal PDF of Xi. And again, I take the log. And here, I calculate the backward probability using the formula that you have just seen. And the rest is as before. I calculate the ratio of the two terms for the alpha, and I take the log. So this is the log formula. And if it is accepted, my candidate becomes the current state. And in any case, I put beta in the set of draws. That's again very simple to code. So this is the results with the lambda equals 0.1. Lambda is the step along the random walk. And here I have an accept rate of 8.6%. And as you can see, the chain converges quite quickly towards the stationary distribution that we aim for. I have again tested a longer lambda, and we have basically, at least qualitatively, the same result. So because we jumped too far, a lot of draws are rejected, so we have a very low accept rate, and it takes longer for the chain to converge to the stationary distribution. And here I have something more interesting. So if I take a small lambda, so what does it mean if I take a small lambda? I perform a step along the gradient, and then I perform a random walk, which basically stays in the same neighborhood as the point that I have obtained. I don't go very far. But now I want to calculate the backward probability. How do I come back? Well, the problem is that to come back, I need to calculate another gradient and another random walk. But if the gradient goes away from the previous state, there is no hope that with a step lambda 0.01, I come back to it. So therefore, in this case, the process is not well designed, and in particular, it cannot go backward or with very low probability. And the consequence is that all the candidates that have been proposed have been rejected because they are not consistent with the target probability. So it's again an extreme example where it shows that the design of the Markov process is extremely important. I have also compared the draws from the random walk and the gradient-based Markov chains for each parameter. So this is for the intercept for car. This is for the intercept for train. And this is for the time coefficient and the cost coefficient. And generally speaking, they look similar. So we have a similar distribution. The draws from the gradient base look a little bit smoother, but this is quite subjective and doesn't make a big difference. And finally, I want to make the point that you can be as creative as you want. You can combine things. Everything that you believe is useful to explore your space in a better way can be done. So just to give you an example here, I say, okay, I have two ideas, the random walk on the one hand, the gradient-based approach on the other hand. I can combine them. I can say with probability P, I perform a random walk, and with probability 1 minus P, I perform a gradient step at each iteration. The only thing you have to do for a given process, you have to derive the forward and backward probability. So in this case, it's relatively simple. The forward probabilities are the random walk with probability P and the random walk for probability 1 minus P. So in this case, we have again the same probability as for the random walk. And for the backward, we have again the random walk, and with probability 1 minus P, we have this backward probability for the gradient-based approach that we have derived before. So it's extremely simple. I have tried it, so with various values of lambda. So this is the one for lambda equals 0.1, we have an accept rate of 8.3%. Again, it goes very well. If I increase the value of lambda, we have, again, a very small accept rate and a long time to converge to the real distribution. But now, if we have a low value of lambda, we have a high accept rate, but which is basically due to the fact that we do random work. It's very likely, as we saw before, that any step that was tried in using a gradient-based approach was rejected. But at least the combination of the two allows us to converge to the true distribution. And again, I compare the draws, so here between the random walk and the mixed from each parameter, and you can see that they are, again, quite similar in nature. And beta cost. From these examples, I wanted to show you two things, is that the basic implementation of the algorithm is quite simple, but details are important. In particular, the way your initial Markov process that I characterized by the matrix Q is designed is very important. It will affect a lot the speed and the efficiency of the algorithm, and also the probability that it will ever converge. But there are other details that are important, and I would like to mention some practical considerations in the case if you want to implement this algorithm. The first recommendation is to use several chains in parallel. So typically, we use multiple starting points and we generate multiple Markov chains. And each of them starts with a different starting point. A key difficulty is, how do you detect that the chain has reached stationarity? Because it's only when it has reached stationarity that you can actually draw from the target distribution. So this is an issue. I will provide you some rules to help you doing this. And another issue is that because of the way you have designed your initial Markov process, there will be a strong correlation within the sequences that you generate, especially if you do small steps, but also across the sequences. So the draws will be highly correlated. And because you want to simulate from a large distribution, this may generate inefficiencies in the simulation. So I will show you how to actually calculate these correlations and decide when you can stop the generation of more draws. So how do we manage the sequences of draws that we will generate? So the idea is to generate several sequences of draws. So here I have capital S equals 4. I generate 4 sequences of draws, and each of them has a length, let's say, n prime. N prime can be 1 million, whatever. The first thing to do is to drop half of the draws from each sequence. So if you remember, the early draws are not useful, as we saw in several pictures. So as a rule of thumb, it's a good practice to basically drop half of each sequence. Okay, so this goes out, this as well, and we keep the rest. Then we need to calculate correlation and to detect if there is correlation within sequence and across sequence. Each sequence that is left, we split it in 2 parts. Okay, so therefore we will have 2 S sequences. So here S equals 4, so we have 8 sequences. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And each of them has length capital N, which is 1/4 of N prime. And I will consider each of these small sequences separately. If theta is the parameter of interest and theta nm is the draw n from sequence m, I can calculate the between sequence variance using this formula. So capital B is the between sequence variance. So theta bar m is the mean of each sequence, and theta bar is the mean of the mean. I can also calculate the variance within each sequence. Okay, so this is the deviation from the mean. I refer you to this book if you are interested in the detail, but the bottom line is that the quantity, which is denoted r hat n here, which is a function of the between sequence and the within sequence variances that we have just derived, it can be shown that it converges to 1. And as a rule of thumb, you choose capital N, so the length of the sequences, such that this quantity is below 1.1, and then you are all set with stationarity and with the correlation.